Allowed us to come through this week until this appointed time for such a time as this. This is the last day of 2023. And I don't know about you all, but I've been reflecting all week long about how God has been good and how he has done marvelous things in my life. Hallelujah. And how he brought me through many challenges. How he covered me in the year of 2023. Now, I don't know what 2024 holds for me, but I claim and I trust and I have faith in God that he's not going to leave me, but he's going to take care of me in 2024. Amen. So I just want to, at this time, to wish everyone, just in case I don't touch your hand, wish you a happy new year. Amen. We honor the Spirit of Christ in this place, and I feel like you're meditating as I am meditating. I feel like that you're feeling the love of God. Amen. Despite of what we may be going through, despite what may be happening in our life, God is still God. God is still good, and God is still working signs, miracles, and wonders. Amen. Amen. We want to welcome you again. I know that we are having some technical difficulties at this time, and we just want to welcome our Facebook and YouTube viewers. If you are on at this time, we thank you for tuning in with us, and we just honor God, and we thank God for you, and we want to wish you a happy new year as well. So at this time, as I said, we do have technical difficulties right now. We will not have the announcements at this time, but if you will tune in a little later, those announcements will be made on Facebook. So at this time, we're going to pause, and we're going to take up our offering. Are you ready to give on today? Amen. The last day of the year, are you ready to give on today? Amen. If you would just stand to your feet, get your offering in your hands. And we're going to get the offertory prayer, and we're just going to pause and let everyone come in. Amen. Are you ready? Let's go. Lord, I thank you for blessing me with this opportunity to worship you with my tithes and offerings. It is a privilege to give my talents, gifts, and my resources to First Missionary Baptist Church to empower our believers and to present the gospel to this community. We sow this seed into this ministry, being obedient to your word. You said that if I give, it shall be given back to me, good measure, pressed down and shaken together. Lord, I thank you that I don't lack for anything, and that you are able to make all grace, every favor, and earthly blessing come to me in abundance, so that I am always and in all circumstances furnished in abundance for every good work and charitable donation. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Ushers will now take charge. Amen. We thank you for your giving. We thank you, and we ask God to bless it 100-fold. And today is Youth Day today. And our ushers, we got some new ushers, y'all. God is adding to the fold. Amen. Amen. Let's give our youth ushers a hand. Amen. And we thank Brother Cole for working with them so much. Amen. All righty then. Are you ready for the word? Are you ready for some good word? round out the end of this year, where if you would stand on your feet and let us receive our pastor, Pastor Calvin Smith. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Come on and give God some praise. If God had been good to you, you ought to put your hands together, open up your mouth, and give God a crazy praise. Amen. Had it not been for the goodness of the Lord, I don't know where we would be. Amen. We are just so delighted. Thank you, Reverend Garland, for carrying out the preliminaries of the service. We are just so excited about what God has done and what God is getting ready to do. Amen. Praise God. So we're just excited about that. We were going to do a little something to kind of show where we had all the progress that we had made on 2023, and maybe on next Sunday, if the Lord will, if he tarries, we still want to bring that up probably next week. We're going to look at how God has blessed us in 2023, and I'm sure that as you all have been reflecting on this year, you look back and see how good God has been to you. And so can we just take this moment just to give God about 15 or 20 seconds of praise of how he has brought us through 2023. Come on and put your hands together and give God some praise, because he is worthy of all of our praise. Had it not been for the Lord on our side, I don't know where we would be. So we are just so thankful for God. We thank you for his faithfulness, because he was faithful to us, y'all. Even when we were not faithful to him, God was still faithful to us. And so we exalt his name. We glorify his name. We magnify. If I got about three people who would help magnify the name of the Lord. Amen. Praise God. So we are excited for what God has done and is going to do. I do have a word from the Lord today. I want you to consider with me the gospel according to St. John, chapter number 15, verses 1 through 5. The gospel according to St. John, chapter number 15, verses 1 through 5. This is a familiar passage of the scripture. I tried to get away from it all this week, but I was working on two or three sermons at one time, but the Lord kept bringing me back to this particular passage of scripture, and so I said, well, I'm going to be obedient to the Lord, because I believe the Lord is going to speak to us at the end of this year, preparing us, y'all, for the oncoming year of how we are to successfully walk through that part of 2024. The Gospel of John, chapter number 15, verses 1 through 5, you will find these words. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth, that it may bring forth more fruit. There's no fruit, more fruit. Verse number 3. Now ye are cleansed through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except you abide in me. Last verse. I am the vine, Jesus says. Ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bring forth much fruit. So we got no fruit, more fruit, now we got much fruit, for without me you can do. Now can I repeat that last verse one more time? Because sometimes I think that we get beside ourselves and think that we're doing it on our own, but the scripture want to remind us this morning, at the end of that verse he said, because without me you can, I cannot, we cannot do nothing. Amen. I want to speak real briefly the time that we have together today. I want to lift up this passage of scripture, and I want to talk from the subject, divine connection. Divine connection. Father, we thank you, God, for this space and the place. We thank you for this privilege to be on the brink of a new year of 2024. God, I pray at this moment that you will be glorified, your word will be revealed, your presence will be manifested in this place, And because of your word today, we will be conformed to the image of your Son, Jesus Christ. We give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. And if you agree with that prayer, can y'all just shout one time, amen.
Amen.
All right, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Divine connection. I don't know about y'all, but I get excited at the end of a year and the beginning of a new year, because it gives me, y'all, a opportunity to reflect upon and to look at the year that I'm coming out of and embracing the year that I'm going into. When I look at New Year, y'all, I look at a time of recommitment, reconnection, refocused, and being refreshed. And we set goals. Now, you can call them goals, you can call them resolutions, you can call them whatever you like to call it. But the truth of the matter is, it gives us, Walter, a time of reflection whereby that we can look at the tapestry of our life and make some goals, make some judgments in how we can better connect with the relationship with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The new year actually always gives us the idea of a fresh start, starting over. Anybody just want an opportunity just to start over? There may be some things that we said, maybe some things that we've done. Maybe we got some unfinished business that God has told us to do and we didn't finish it. But thank God that we have an opportunity to start over. We bid farewell, y'all, to the past, and we embrace new doors of opportunities. We look, Walter, at new windows of possibilities and a chance to modify some undeserved or at least undesired behaviors and to become what God has designed for us to become. I'm excited also because I get an opportunity to look at the new traditions or the traditions that we do in New Year's. I was reminded in my research, I looked at Spain, and in Spain, what they do on New Year's Eve, they will eat 12 white grapes because the grapes are a symbol of prosperity. So in Spain, they will eat a dozen of white grapes symbolizing the hopes for the months ahead and prosperity. In Cuba and Australia and Portugal, they will eat pig or pork because pig represents progress and pork represents prosperity. And so pork appears on the New Year's Eve table in Cuba and Australia. In Sweden and in Norway, rice pudding is the big thing there. And what they would do, they would put an almond in the rice pudding. And whoever can find that almond, they says, when you find the nut, you can expect 12 months of good fortune. In America, especially in the South, many will gather tomorrow, including myself. We'll gather tomorrow at a table that's sitting around black-eyed peas, collard greens, and cornbread. Now, I don't know if y'all don't realize what that means, but what it means, the collard greens is money folded. Come on, somebody. The black-eyed peas talks about prosperity, and the cornbread talks about gold. And so there are other traditions, Walter, that we embrace. We'll probably look at tonight, we'll probably look at fireworks. Some of the greatest fireworks that you will see will be coming out of London and Sydney and Chicago. I think they also have some fireworks in New York City. But in New York City, I don't know how many of y'all are going to be able to watch the ball drop tonight. I will not be among you. Amen. My cutoff time is 10 o'clock. Amen. But those of you who can stay up to 12:01 in New York City and Times Square, they're going to drop the ball to celebrate and to bring in the new year. Churches even have, especially the black churches, we still have traditions in our black church since that Freedom's Eve, which the slaves had embraced. The black community have gathered in black churches all across America to have what we call watch night services. And we use the watch night services, y'all, in praising and glorifying God to symbolize that the same way we went out of that year, that same praise and that same giving God the glory, we're going to do it in that following year. But there's also another tradition that we embrace. At the end of every year, there'll be a prophetic word that will come forth from prophets and those who are standing in the pulpits all across America today. They will share with their congregation, like I'm going to share with you in a moment, what they feel as though that they have heard the Lord say. In 2020, y'all remember the vision and the prophetic word was Vision 2020, meaning that we're going to be able to have a clear vision of what God is trying to do. In 2021, the theme of that year was divine intervention, which means that God was going to intersect. God was going to intervene in the affairs of the people in history. In 2022, they said that this was a year of sufficiency, saying that God was going to supply all of our needs according to his riches in glory. Y'all remember last year in 2023, they come up with a theme that says being free in 2023. I was looking at the prophets as I was preparing. And so this year, the prophets are saying more in 2024. Amen. And so this is a word that the prophetic voices ring out and give to America. But I also have a word for this house. I can't speak for other houses, but I've heard a word from the Lord for this house. And what God is sharing with me is, yeah, it may be a year of acceleration. It may be a year of prosperity. It may be a year of supernatural interventions. But what God is saying to me and what God want me to share with you on this morning is none of that is possible without divine connection. None of that is possible without a relationship built on God. God is telling me that this is the year that the believer have to stop playing with God. That we got to be serious and begin to start putting the relationship and the developing the relationship with God as a priority and take it off the back burner and let that be the focus. Let that be the moral compass in which you and I as believers will do. When I look at the word divine, divine means something that's supernatural. Divine means there's something that has something to do with God. When something is divine, it's talking about something that's coming directly from God. But then when you talk about connection, you're talking about the ability to link two or more things together. So divine connection, family of God, if I had to define it, it's simply this. The supernatural act of God, whereby he links up with a person, for the purpose of fulfilling the purpose and the plan that God has for you in my lives. When I begin to start thinking about divine connections, we have divine connections throughout the scriptures. I began watching, start thinking about the 10 lepers. Y'all remember the story, don't you? In Luke chapter 17, verses 11 through 19, we're told of 10 lepers who were isolated on the outside of their community because they had this horrendous disease that separated them and isolated them from the community. The Bible says that they were outside of town. Because of the disease that they had, they were not able to participate in social activities. They were unable to go to church and to worship God. They were unable to go to Food Line, if you will, to even buy and purchase food. They had no hope or human contact except for those who had the same problem that they were dealing with. In fact, they were sheltered in place. So sheltered in place, family of God, is not a new terminology. It's not a new phenomenon, because they were actually sheltered in place. And if that was not bad enough, the Jewish law required them to shout when people began to start coming to them, unclean, unclean, to let people know of their disease, to let people know that if you get too close, you can become contaminated with the disease that I have. It was not only the private humiliation of being isolated from the community. It was the open public display that we had to wash out our laundry before other people and let other people know and to recognize that we have an insufficiency, that we got a problem in our life. I don't know about you, but the private humiliation is one thing. But when you got to go public and allow other people to know and to be able to know and realize that there's something wrong in the life. And when they had found themselves and Jesus was coming, this then was the divine connection. They yelled out to Jesus, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." Jesus then, moving with compassion, told them to go show themselves to the priest. And as they were going, they were healed. We know that only one leper returned and gave God glory. But the other nine who failed to return had their life back, had their purpose back, had their dreams back. So let's not be too harsh on the other nine, because the reality and the truth is God has done some things for us in 2023 that we failed to stop to give God thanks. We stopped to fail to give God thanks that he provided air for us to breathe. We probably forgot to give God thanks, as the old people say, that my blood is running warm in my veins. We probably stopped and realized and didn't give God thanks, as the old people say, that I got activity of my limbs. And I'm clothed, they used to say, in my right mind. And so sometimes before we get to become too harsh upon the other nine, we got to realize they had their life back. They had their families back. They had their careers back. They had their dreams back. And because of the divine connection, Jesus changed the narrative of their lives. And I just simply want to come by this morning to tell us that if we include Jesus as the divine connection, he will change the tapestry of our lives. He will promote a new narrative in your life. It doesn't matter what it used to be, but it can be what God has created it to be. I think about blind Bartimaeus. I think about Peter walking on the water. And all of these examples is a reflection of the divine connection with Jesus. And when they become connected to Jesus, the landscape of their life begin to start change. I want to say this morning, in 2024, I want you to get ready. I want you to buckle up your seatbelts. I want you to stand at your tent door and be very observant, because the year of 2024, I hear God clearly saying, there's going to be a social unrest in this country like you have never seen it before. He said that the social unrest is going to be so violent that there will be a fighting and a violence in the streets that you and I are walking apart. I heard the Lord say there will be an explosion. There will be an unraveling of everything that we have put our trust in outside of God. God is saying to us in 2024, I'm going to shake the foundation, said God, that everything that's not connected to me, everything that's not trusting me, everything that's not believing in me, it will be shaken and it will fall down and be destroyed. I heard the Lord say, the guardrails that held us together in the last election, those guardrails would not be strong enough to hold the penetration and the ideals and the violence and the crime that's going to come upon it. It would not withstand, I heard the Lord say, the assault from within and the assault from without. And there will be a shaking, I heard the Lord say, of the very foundation that we have put our trust in and have enjoyed for a long time. We will continue to experience, said the Lord, rumors of wars and of wars. Hundreds and thousands of people will die, said the Lord. There will be millions that will be dying. I heard the Lord say there will be an exposure of the elite, those who are in high-profile positions that will shake the confidence of the followers. And they will look for those false prophets that will lie to them and help them to grab hold to false hope and send them on a path of utterly destruction. In the midst of the chaos, in the midst of the uncertainty, I heard the word of the Lord say this morning in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14 to 17. God said, be careful who you hook up with. Be careful who you connect with. Because the Bible is clear. He says in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17, 14 through 17. I won't read it all, but this is what I heard the Lord say. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship have righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion with light and darkness? Then verse 17 says, wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separated, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, saith the Lord. God is calling us to evaluate our relationships. We are including people in our circle. We're including people in our lives. And we're not realizing that the people that we're connecting ourselves with hold our destiny in their hands. And God said, come out from among them. Come out from among the unbelievers. Come out from among those who are not trusting and believing in God. And God said, when you come out from among them, separate yourself from them. The reason why I hear God say that many are not prospering the way that he wants you to prosper is because of the connections that you are having in your life. I heard God say, he said, don't be influenced by the culture. Listen to what I'm saying, because in 2024, culture is going to tell you how you ought to deal with your problems. Culture is going to suggest to us how we are going to be influenced. Culture is going to tell us how we should deal with our problems and our circumstances. But I heard the word of the Lord say in Romans chapter 12, verse number 2, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. God said, don't let the system of the world shape you, but we are the salt of the earth. We are the light that's set upon the hill that's supposed to influence the world instead of the world influencing us. I hear God saying, and I preached this not too long ago, that there will be a spiritual drifting. And the part about being a spiritual drifting is that you're going to be drifting and you're not even realizing that you're drifting. There are some people, because of COVID-19, they think that their spiritual life is okay. But they think that everything is fine, that they are still connected to God. But God is saying, you are spiritually drifting from me. When you are not reading my word, when you are not in prayer, when you are not in worshiping me, when you are not in fellowship with other believers like yourself, I am spiritual drifting from the Lord. But I'm not a preacher of gloom and doom, but I also hear, in this time, in the midst of the chaos, in the midst of the destruction, in the midst of the calamities, in the midst of the uncertainty, I hear the voice of God saying, praise be to God, I got a revival. There's going to be pockets of revival that's going to break loose, not only in America, but revival is going to break loose in America. I hear the Lord say that South Carolina, it will be one of the first places that revival is going to break out. I hear God say Maine. I hear God say Australia, that revival is going to break out. But God also said, don't leave you out. All these saints the remnants who've been praying, who've been fasting for revival. God is saying, I'm going to breathe on your situation. The wind of God's breath will encompass you, and revival is going to break out in your home. Revival is going to break out in your life. Revival is going to break out in your family. Revival is going to break out in your church. Revival is going to break out in the community, saith the Lord. The remnant of God who've been praying. And I hear God say that we'll see the fresh winds of the Holy Spirit blow through their families. God is going to raise up men and women, says God, who people don't recognize. Their names are not familiar. Their names are not on the boards, Walter. But God is going to raise up men and women out of storefront churches to carry his gospel, because they've been faithful over the little things, saith God. And God said, because they have been faithful, I'm going to raise them up, and I'm going to trust the things of God. And when they begin to start preaching, the people will return back to the church in 2024. I know that we've been saying that people are gone, but because of the exposure, but because of the destruction that's going to take place in 2024, I heard God said that the people are going to come back like locusts. It reminds me of the border now in Mexico, where people are coming back in the hundreds and thousands. God said there will be a return to the body of Christ. Hundreds and thousands will return to the house of God to give him glory, to give him praise, to edify him because of who he is. I hear the Lord say that the church has to be prepared. He has to be prepared for the influx of people that's coming our way, which means, y'all, that we got to get ourselves in position. We can no longer afford to play church. We got to get serious about this thing, because I believe with all my heart that First Missionary Baptist Churches is one of the churches that God is going to use to be a voice in this city. I believe that God is going to use this church to be an impact in Thomasville and in North Carolina and across the nations. God is saying, we want you to be prepared. And when I read that, I said, well, God, what does it really mean? And then he reminded me of Elijah, when God had put Elijah behind a rock. Y'all remember the story in 1 Kings where Elijah was hiding behind the rock, and the Bible says, God says that he brought food to Elijah in the morning with the sparrow, with the ravens. He brought food early in the morning, and he brought fruit late at night. But there was a spring there that Elijah would go drink from time to time. But as the days went forth, said the Lord, the water began to start drying up. And I come to tell somebody this morning with the prophetic word, you keep going to the same spring, but the water is drying up. God is moving you to another place. He's moving you to another level. He's moving you to another ministry. And God is saying that in this time and in this season, it was a time for Elijah to prepare, because God had another assignment for Elijah. And that assignment was to go to Zarephath, because God said that in Zarephath is where your blessings are. And I come to tell somebody today, don't just stay where you are. Sometimes you got to move to get your blessing. Sometimes you got to think outside of the box to get the blessing that God has for us. I hear the Lord say that in the last several years, the COVID-19 has separated my body, have separated people from one another. And I'm hearing the God is still saying, but this will be a time, saith the Lord, that I will open up doors of possibilities. I will open up doors of opportunities. I will open up new realms of possibilities. We will become inventors. We will become have ideas. God is going to give us strategies that we have never seen before. God is going to give us ministries and business. And this is what I heard God say finally. God is saying, I will cause you to plant wherever that you are. See, y'all missed that. Can I take my time and tell you what God is saying? See, some of us are trying to be uprooted. Some of us are trying to go into new places. God said, no, what I want you to do is prosper right there where you are. Wherever that you are planted, prosper. Wherever that you are planted, do the best that you can to bring out the best of you can. Because in that place, the Bible tells us that Isaiah had a seed. But Isaiah was going to Egypt, which is a symbolism of the world. So God had given the seed. And I come to tell somebody today, some people talking about they don't have the seed. God always give seed to the sower. God always give seed to the sower. It's what we're doing with the seed that actually matters. If you hold the seed, if you disqualify the seed, then you will not have what God will have you to do. But Isaiah was getting ready to go to Egypt. And what God is telling us, don't depend on the systems of Egypt. Don't depend on the systems of this world. And I remember Jesus, when Jesus said, he says, listen, he was talking to one of the Pharaohs. And Jesus told, he said, my kingdom, my rule, my authority, where I get my instructions from, is not of this world. But it's from another kingdom. And God is saying, when you plant your seed, don't plant your seed in this system. He come outside of Oshia. I also hear the Lord say, he said, don't tie your money up in investments. Money market. What are some of those other things that we invest in? IRAs, and he said, don't put your trust in that. The financial institution is going to crumble. And the only seed that you need to sow that can bring you a return is in the kingdom of God. I'm staying in the word because God told Isaac, he said, look, sow your seed right here. Where? In this land. And God is telling us that we cannot afford to sow the seed in the world, but sow the seed in the economy of God. Because I don't know about you. When I sow a seed in the economy of God, God gives me a 100-fold return. In fact, the Bible declares that when Isaiah sowed the seed in a famine, I know it don't look good. I know it don't make any sense. But God says, sow it anyway. And because you're going to be obedient to the voice of God, God said, I'm going to give you not a 30-fold increase. I'm not going to give you just a 40-fold increase. God said, I'm going to give you the same increase that I gave Isaiah, that I'm going to give you a 100-fold increase. Is there anybody in the house this morning can use a 100-fold increase? Somebody give God a praise. This is a time of divine connection. I wish I could tell you that it was going to be a year of acceleration where you don't have to adjust nothing, where you don't have to make any decisions to do anything. God's saying there will be an acceleration, but the acceleration is going to be because you connected to me. Brings me to my passage of scripture. The first thing that I want to bring out, I hope you write it down, is this. The Bible says, and number one, my first point is this. You got to let the connection be a priority. We cannot afford to put it on the back burner anymore. Because of the devastation in 2024, you got to know how to navigate through this thing. And if you're not connected, how are you going to be able to hear the voice of God? If you're not connected, how are you going to be able to navigate through the hills and the valleys and the difficulties and the trials and the tribulations? How are you going to be able to navigate? God told me to prepare my people because I will show my mighty hand, saith the Lord. So the first thing that God is saying to us, that we have to make the connection with God priority. Listen to what he says. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. The vine is the source. What we have done, family of God, even as the household of faith, even as believers, we have begun to start trusting on other systems. But more importantly, we have begun to start trusting in ourselves. God is saying, this is the time, this is a season that you got to reconnect back to me. You got to allow me to be your source, because the truth of the matter is, everything else that we're dependent on is shakable. The only thing that is consistent is the source of God. The only thing that is consistent is God has been faithful to us even when we have not been faithful to him. God is our source. When friends walked out, God was still our friends. When we needed a doctor in the sick room, God was our doctor. When we needed a lawyer in the courtroom, God was the source of our lawyer. When you just needed somebody to talk to, God was that friend that was standing beside his brother. We got to stay connected. We got to understand that God and God alone is our source. I want to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 6. And if you will look at it in the Amplified Bible, it says this. He says, yet for us there is only one God, the Father, who is the source of all things. If we miss that point, we're going to be relying upon man. We're going to be relying upon institutions. We're going to be relying upon policies and legislations. And I'm here to tell y'all, all of that stuff is going to crumble down. The only source that we can rely on is the source of God, of us being as a branch connected to the vine and allowing that vine to give us all the source and the nutrients and the nitrogen, everything that we need to walk a healthy and a successful Christian life. We got to be connected. It must be a priority. And when I talk about priority, y'all, hear this. The branch's job, y'all, is not to make it happen. The branch's job, watch this, is just to stay connected. Turn to somebody, just say, just stay connected. You ain't got to do nothing. You ain't got to force nothing. You don't have to manage it. And I know for some of y'all, that's going to be hard, because some of y'all are really controlled people, right? But you ain't got to control nothing. You ain't got to manage nothing. All he's saying is this: as a branch, just stay connected to the vine. And as you stay connected to the vine, everything that you need, God will supply all, not some, all of your needs according to his riches in glory. We don't have to worry about 2024, even though there's going to be devastation. Why? Because we're a child of God. We are the sons and daughters of God. We serve a God that sits high and looks low, that have all resources to his availability. He created the heavens and the earth. He created you and I. Don't you know that if he is the creator, he's going to take care of his creature? The purpose. So we see Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. Write it down. This is a principle that I want you really to hold on to as you embrace 2024. And it says something like this. He says, Matthew 6:33, he says, seek, which means that you are not just going to haphazardly walk on it. Seek means that you got to be intentional, y'all. You got to be intentional in 2024. You just can't haphazardly live. You just can't keep wandering around with no purpose and no destiny and no meaning in life. God said the only way that you're going to find purpose in life, the only way that we're going to find meaning in life, is to go back to the one who created you. Yeah, yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He says stay connected. But seek means that you have to intentionally do something. I come against the enemy right now in the name of Jesus that have clouded our minds to think that God was something of a person that we can just wave our wand and get what we wanted and not invest anything in our spiritual care. God is saying, if you want what I want, you got to do what I've asked you to do. And he said, watch this. He said, if you draw near unto me, but the first part of it was, Walter, I had to take the initiative. I had to do something. I had to be intentional and draw unto God. And as I drew unto God, then God drew unto me. Amen. And so we look at the connection being priority. So then I ask this question. What decision are you going to make this year to make God priority? What adjustments do you and I need to make in our life to take God off the back burner and let him be the first, I remember the old saints used to say, you know, the Lord is the first in my life. We say that. But what are we willing to do to ensure that God has priority in our life? When we make a decision, are we going to go to the Word of God? Are we just going to make it based upon what we feel? Or make it based upon somebody that we don't call on the phone who is in the same shape that you in? What goals are we going to set? If you're doing a resolution, that's fine. But what goals are you going to set? What adjustments in your life? Because I'm coming to tell y'all this. Do not buy into the prophetic word that you don't have to do nothing and receive the blessings of God. We have to make the necessary adjustments to ensure and to develop and to nurture our relationship with God. Watch this. Because see, the enemy, he know that y'all ain't gonna do a whole lot of things. You know, some of us, when they got too old, you can't do no whole lot of things. That's supposed to be funny. But what he does is, if I can just sever the relationship between you and God, if I can just create a crack in that relationship, if I can create a separation in that relationship, you and I will never be able to walk in the purpose and the destiny that God has called us to do. So we got the priority of the connection. Can I talk to y'all about the second thing? And it is the purpose of the connection. There's a purpose in being connected to the vine. It's just not to be a pew member. No. The purpose of being connected to the vine, y'all, is to be fruitful. Okay, let me go back to the text. Watch what the text said. Verse number 2. I'm in the book. He said, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, watch this, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purge it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now, I want to go back to the front part where it says, those who beareth not fruit, he taketh away. When we read this portion of scripture, we think that Jesus is saying that he's going to get rid of that branch or that part of the vine, or because why? It's not producing fruit. Just think about it for a minute. God is the husbandman. Jesus is the vine dresser. And we are the branches. Think about this. Everything is in the garden. So what is the job of the vine dresser? The vine dresser is to make sure that he gets the best product, the most product out of the vines that he have there. So if he's cutting off every vine that's not producing fruit, then he is cutting himself out of production of wine. Are y'all with me so far? So what he's saying is, in essence, when he says he taketh away, it really means he lifted up. Because if you go back to the Eastern, in this first century culture, when they walked through the grape field, there were vines that was that had maybe clods of dirt over it, and the sun couldn't get to it. And so, excuse me. What the vine dresser would do, he would go, he would lift up that leaf, he would put it on a stick, get it away from the dirt, and so the light could shine on it. So it wasn't the fact that he was giving up on that particular vine. He's just saying that he's going to take it up, he's going to prepare it. Now, this is the thing. Spiritually, what it tells me is, watch this, don't miss this, there is more in you than what you were experiencing. Problem is, y'all, we done got comfortable with it. When God has purposed more and much, we have become custom and familiar with the done. All we want to do is be saved. You're going to go to heaven, but you're not bearing no fruit. The fruit is the purpose of being connected. It's thank God that you're saved. But in this year 2024, you got to be more than saved. I said you got to be more than saved. You got to be producing something. And so God is saying he's trying to lift you up. He's trying to help you to walk in the potential that he has prepared for you and I. Jeremiah puts it like this. He says, For I know the plan, said Jeremiah, that I have for you, said the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. But this is the challenge. God knows the plan, but do we? You got to search out the plan of God. We got to start looking at the potential. Our responsibility is to find out what God's plan is for our lives. The only way that we can find out what God's plan is for our lives is for us to be connected. Because he's the one who made the plans. And so what happens is we're asking everybody, well, what should I do? What school should I go to? What career should I advance on? What relationships should I be in? And you're asking people who has limited knowledge. Right. I want to ask somebody who got the answers. I know. Now, watch this. I know our parents, they did what they did. We love them to death. But I'm going to say we love our parents. But I heard my parents say one thing. He say, don't never question God. Well, I kind of differ with that because the fact is, if y'all ain't got the answer. I need to go to somebody who got the answer. God is not intimidated because I asked him a question. Because he got the answer. If I ask in prayer, the Bible says in 1 John 5, he said, this is the confidence that I have. If I pray according to the will of God, God hears me. And if he hear me, he'll give me the petition in which it's said. But if I never have the petition, then God is not going to give me the request. Amen. This is a hard sermon. So then he says, bear fruit, Walt. So then there are two types of fruit. There's an inward fruit, and then there's an outward fruit. Right? Both of these fruits are going to help us in 2024. Watch this. You don't want to exclude something because you don't know what's working. You know what I mean? Watch this. Whether it's Bible reading, we're going to get there in a minute. Prayer, worship, evangelism. I need to do all of it because I don't know which one is going to be working at that right time in my life to push me over, to help me to facilitate and to navigate 2024. All right, watch this. I'm getting ready to go. So the outward fruit is this. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, this is the outward fruit. He says, for we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus under good works, which God has preordained that we should walk in them. You have been predestined to do good works. Then people talk about, well, you know, we let the enemy, well, you know, because of what you've been through and where you are now, you ain't got nothing to offer. That's not according to what the word says. All of us got weaknesses. All of us got shortcomings. But one thing I learned about God, y'all, and maybe y'all can testify with me, is that at any given point that I forget about myself and start promoting the kingdom of God, somehow or another, God interferes in my situation and make my situation a whole lot better. Can I get a testimony? Is that anybody's testimony? When you forfeited yourself, when you stop thinking about your own self and start being concerned and compassionate about somebody else, somehow or another, y'all, God will step in, right the wrong. He'll bring down low he'll raise up the valleys and bring down the mountains in my life. And then all of a sudden, what I had was no longer an issue. Are y'all getting blessed? I'm going to rush on. But that's an outward fruit. Then you got the inward fruit. Friend of God, you and I, we can never make it in 2024 if we don't allow the inward fruit to govern our lives. Why? Because the inward fruit deals with our character. Look around the culture today. There is no integrity. There's no character. I mean, people are just lying. They're stealing. They're deceit. They're greedy. No character. But we ought to be different, y'all. In 2024, let's not fall into that category. Let's be different. Let people see that something is different about you and me. Amen? All right, so there's an inward fruit. He says, Galatians 5, chapter 22, 23. Please write this down. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. Honey, we're going to have to love folks that's unlovable. Amen. They don't deserve it because what they've done or said or whatever the case may be. And this is a fruit I can't produce on my own. The only thing I could do as a branch is stay connected to the vine. And somehow or another, the branch gives me the ability to love the unlovable, to have peace in the midst of chaos, to walk in faith even though I cannot see what the outcome is going to be, to be disciplined enough to govern my steps according to the word of God. So that's the inward fruit. All right, so then we talk about the priority. Then we talk about the purpose. Can I talk about the preparation of the connection? The preparation. This is real important, y'all. Now, watch this. I am not getting ready to give y'all something you ain't never heard before. Y'all know what I'm hearing God say. God say, we need to, as the believers of Christ, we need to go back to the basics. The basic work in the early church. Fellowship, reading of the word, worship, evangelism, ministry. It worked in the early church. God is telling us we need to go back. So these are the things that's going to prepare us for 2024. If you want to learn how or know how to operate in 2024, I'm going to give you four principles. I can almost assure you that if you implement these four principles, that no matter what happens in 2024, you're going to be able to navigate and live a successful Christian life. The first principle is this, Bible intake. The Bible is God's love story to us, y'all. If you want to know the revelation of God, or you want to know who God is, God will manifest himself in Scripture, the Bible. Now, we all know how important it is, but are we willing to make the priority of reading the Bible? It's got quiet in here. I'm not giving you no glorified anything. I'm just sharing with you what God is sharing with me that we got to get back to. If we're going to have a divine connection with God, these are the things that God is requiring us to do to have that connection. You got to read the Bible. Amen? And watch this. Because why? You say, well, Pastor, why do I need to read the Bible? Because there's going to be some things that happen in 2024. You're going to be at a crossroad, and you don't know how to make that decision. Watch what the Bible does. I'm going to give you the word of God. Listen to Psalm 119, 105. Because I can assure you that sometime in this year, you're going to have to make a decision that you don't know which decision to make. Watch what the word says. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet. Which means, Walter, if it's a lamp unto my feet, he's not talking about far yonder. He's talking about, okay, what's my next step? What's the next thing I need to do? See, some of us, we're trying to look way by now. God said, no. Use the word of God as a lamp to find out what your next move is. What's your next decision? And you base that decision upon the word of God. Then watch what he does. He says, not only am I a lamp unto your feet, he said, then I'm going to be a light. Watch this. Which means, Walter, now that the light give me more ability to see what's in front of me. The lamp, I can just see right in front of me. But when he give me the light, then I can see everything in front of me. In 2024, you're going to need the word of God to not only illuminate right where you are for your next decision, you're going to need the word of God to illuminate where you can see a little bit further. Amen. I see y'all listening, right? So he's going to give us instruction. Do y'all know that the Bible has life in it? The Bible has life in it, y'all. See, we look at it as a book. It's not just a book. It's not a religious book. It's life. Listen to what John 16:33 says. 63. It is the spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profited nothing. But the words Jesus said, I speak unto you, they are spirit and life. Do you want life? Do you want the abundant life? Are you okay with just surviving? We got to get out of the mindset, well, you know, we just got enough to keep our head. We should never say that, y'all. Those words should never come out of us. Well, we just got just enough to keep our head above water. That's not how we live. We walk by faith, not by sight. We look at those things that are unseen, not at the things which are seen, because the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are unseen are eternal. Is anybody getting blessed? Is anybody receiving this prophetic word today? All right, so then I'm going to give you one more and move on. The word of God matures us. We got to grow up. There's going to be some challenges in 2024 that baby Christians are going to struggle with. We got to mature. We got to grow up. Listen to what the word of God says. 2 Timothy 3:16, 17. All scripture, the word of God, is given by the inspiration of God. Do y'all believe that? Well, if you believe that the scriptures are inspiration of God, then we probably need to make some adjustments to make room in our schedule to read the word of God. Why? Because it's the inspiration of God. This is simple. Amen. But it's requiring you something. See, I'm not going to be that pastor to tell y'all, well, you just do what you want to do, and the Lord knows your heart. Yeah, he do know a heart. And he knows sometimes we got a slow for heart. That we're not willing to pay the price to be connected to God, to bring forth the fruitfulness that God is requiring in all of our lives. Nobody's exempt, because in your life there is an arena and an influence that you have with the circle of people that's around you. So you can be fruitful in that area. Everybody look at it. Y'all listen. So number one, Bible intake. Second, I'm not giving you no grandiose word. Prayer. Now I'm going to stop right there. And let me tell you this. I'm not changing the theme of this year. Every year, I usually have a theme. Last year's theme was, this house shall be called a house of prayer. God still wants us to stay on this theme. You want to know why? Because we're not doing it. We're not doing it. It's an idea. It's a cliche. We got it tacked on the side of the building. But are we really praying? Only you can answer that. But if we're going to operate at corporately as a church and individually as a mother, a father, a family, because whatever decisions they make on Capitol Hill, they're going to affect you. So I don't care what they do. Yeah, you better care. And you better be praying. The Bible is clear. He said, pray for those who have authority, those who are in those positions. I don't care who it is, whether it's a Republican or a Democrat, are we praying for them? Prayer is essential. If we're going to operate, and you say, well, Pastor, how does it, because, again, you're going to run up on that crossroad, and if you can't find it in the Bible or you can't see it in the Bible, you know how he's going to give you clarity? He's going to speak to you in prayer. So watch this, y'all. If I cut out prayer, and if I cut out reading the Bible, I've just cut off two mechanisms where God speaks to me. And you know what we start relying upon? How we feel has nothing to do with the word of God. Because sometimes I got some feelings going on right now I want to act out on. Come on, y'all. I'm just trying to be transparent. I got some feelings, y'all, or something that happened that I want to act out on. But you know what I found out in this journey? The very thing that God is telling me to do is the very thing that I probably need to do. Because when I listen to my flesh, come on, somebody, y'all ain't praying with me. Y'all act like this. Y'all ain't never been at that crossroad where somebody done tick you off and you felt as though that they done abandoned you, or you felt as though that they've taken advantage of you in some kind of a way, right? And then we play it off. Well, you know, I don't forgive them until you see them, and then the hair on the back of your neck stand up because you really ain't forgave them. I know I'm in the house. Amen. Praise God. So prayer is, watch what Colossians chapter 4, I'm getting ready to close, y'all. I know y'all tired of me. Colossians chapter 4, verse 2, this is coming out of the HSSB. Watch what it says. Devote yourselves, in the King James Version, it says continue in prayer. But this version says devote yourself to prayer. Stay alert in it with thanksgiving. The word devote don't mean that you just casually just pray. Devote means that you are intentionally carving out an area of your life and time where you can spend with God. Devote is short for devotional. What are we doing in our devotion? Come on, y'all. Because I'm telling y'all, I'm giving y'all what God has given me. 2024 ain't going to be no joke, y'all. It ain't going to be no joke. And so we got to prepare ourselves for what's coming. How many of y'all got water at your house? Toilet paper. Stocked up. Go get you something, put it in the stock. Because y'all remember what happened to COVID-19? When the time came, y'all couldn't find no water. You couldn't find no tissue to wipe yourself with. You couldn't find none of that. Why? Because you wasn't prepared. Come on, y'all. We got to wake up. Tell me, well, you know, the God was our place. No, he gave us wisdom. We can see, the Bible says, he said, well, you can look around and see when it's fall because you can look at the color of the leaf. Can't we open up our spiritual eyes and see that danger is coming? Yeah. Let me say something else. I'm off script now. Get debt free. Stop buying stuff that you don't need. Soon as you pay off one bill, you go get another bill. But then you can't pay your tithes. You can't invest in the kingdom of God. We got to grow up. Because this year, there's going to be a great falling away. Because we're not going to want to do what the word says do. And then when we do that, we're going to get what we get. The church, and I'm going to talk to my officers. We need to either get use that place across the street. We need to store up some water. We need to get food in there. Because people in this church may not adhere to what I'm preaching today. And this is going to be a time they may need something to eat. They ought to be able to come to church and get some green beans or something from the storehouse. I'm serious, y'all, when I tell y'all that God is telling me to help prepare y'all to what's coming. We're sitting around like in Ephesians 5, we sleep. God said, wake up and look around and see what's going on. Things that we have enjoyed, the next generation would not enjoy it. Amen. Are we preparing our children? Amen. Or have we bought into the culture? How much teaching are we doing them at home? Are we just allowing the system to teach them, or are we teaching them? And then the system come in behind and edify what we already done. But many of us, we're relying upon the system who's telling our children that it's okay to be gay. Express yourself, they say. You have a right to choose what sex you're going to be. You tell me any 7-year-old that has enough experience and wisdom and knowledge to decide what sex they're going to be. But we as the parents, well, we want them to express themselves. My mama and y'all mama would have smacked us in the mouth. Y'all know they would. Y'all know I'm telling the truth. You go over there, listen, you don't talk, and this is grown folk conversation. You speak when you're spoken to. Amen. But we want to understand our kids. No, until you start paying your darn bills, Y'all ain't got to pray with me. I'm going to rejoice all by myself. We got children telling parents what they need to do. Well, I'm not going to church today. No, you going. I don't care how late you stayed out last night. You going to church today. I don't care. If you got liquor on your breath, whatever clothes you got on, take a shower, put something on, we going to church. Well, you know, Johnny didn't want to go to church today. No, you living in my house. And in my house, Joshua said, he said, in my house, we're going to serve the Lord. If I get up and go to church, you're going to get up and go to church. Watch this. Watch this. The Holy Spirit is speaking to us today. Not only that, if I get up and go to work, you getting up going to work, praise God. I'm not going to work and you laying there watching TV and playing games. Then you got my car and you have the audacity not to be on time to pick me up on my job. I'm preaching today. I said, I'm preaching today. I'm gonna bring this new year in right. I'm going to say what thus said the Lord. Last thing, y'all. I know y'all ready for me to stand down and shut up somewhere. Last thing, y'all. Worship. You know what I found out? For a lot of us, because we don't have a musician and a praise team, our worship is slack. If your worship is dependent upon somebody sitting over on that organ or a praise team standing in front of you, you better check yourself. Because that's not true worship. When I think about the goodness of Jesus and all he done for me, I don't care if they ain't got no organist. I don't care if there's no praise team. I'm going to come in and give God the highest praise because the fact of the matter is, y'all, he woke me up this morning, closed in my right mind. I got the activities on my limbs. I got a clear mind. Worship is not what we do from 10:45 to 11. Worship is a lifestyle. We living foul all week. Then talk about coming here worship. Don't you know you bringing a foreign substance to a worship experience? And if you know anything about the Word of God, you cannot bring foreign matter in worship and think you're going to walk away scot-free. Worship is a lifestyle. In fact, the way I like to explain it, Walton, I'm getting ready to go. The way I like to explain it, worship is a continuation of what I've been doing all week. Amen. Well, I'm done now. Worship is both a lifestyle and an activity. Yes, it's praising God, it's adoring God, it's expressing reverence to God. These are all acts of worship. But the major act of worship, what am I going to do tomorrow? How am I going to respond to a difficult person in my life? How am I going to make my decisions? Is it going to be based upon the Word of God, or is it going to be based upon how I feel? We are getting ready to go into a turbulent time. I wish I could tell you that it wasn't, but the good news is I've just given us the recipe of how to walk through this process and come out successfully. Come on and give God a praise. Divine connection. If you don't hear nothing else, I want you to hear this. Stay connected to the vine. Because out of that connection flows all the other issues of life. It's the connection that you have with Jesus Christ. Whether you're trying to be a better mother, a better father, a better grandparent, or just a better person in general, all of that flows out of that relationship, that connection that you have with Jesus Christ. You remember what the Bible says? He said, because without him, That's what he says. We can do nothing. Let's not embrace 2024 on our own initiative, but let's embrace it dependent upon the connection and the relationship with God. And let us, at this moment, tonight, I hope it just permeates your spirit soul, that when you make that resolution, that you intentionally in your mind say, I'm going to do something that's going to help me develop a relationship with God. Yeah, we can do losing weight. We can do eating better. We can do all of those things. But if your relationship with God is not intact, none of that stuff matters. You're just going to die and go to hell in good health. Yep. So I know this may not have been your normal New Year's Eve message, but it's the message that God gave me, and it's the message that I had to deliver. And I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying right now, let those who have ears to hear, let them hear what the Spirit, not Calvin, but the Spirit have spoke this morning through this vehicle called Calvin, but the Spirit of the Lord has spoken. Yield ye us unto him. God bless you. Let's give God a praise. Amen. All right. So we're going to bid those. Are we on Facebook? Okay. We're going to bid those who are watching us on Facebook Live and YouTube. Thank you so much for being a part of this New Year's Eve service. My prayer is I hope and pray that you got something out of this message that will equip you, that will empower you, that will ignite you, that will energize you, that when you embrace this year of 2024, you'll have the tools to deal with whatever comes up in your life or the life of your family. Godspeed. God bless you. Thank you for turning in. And please join us on next Sunday as we be led by the Lord in regards to the sermon that will come. God bless you. Amen. For those that are here. What an awesome word of the Lord. I hope it was inspiring to you. I hope it was challenging for you as you walk your Christian journey. And please join us again on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, and hope to be with you again on next Sunday morning.